نحمدہ ونصلی علی رسول الکریم اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ya ayyuhan nas attaqu rabbakum allazi khalakakum min nafsin wahida wa khalaka minha zawjaha wa bassa minhuma rijalan kaseeran wa nisa. He says, O mankind, revere your guardian Allah who created you from a single person and created of like nature his spouse, his mate. And from then he scattered like seeds countless men and women. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had wanted, he could have created all mankind at the same time and said, here, go, I'll test you. He could have created people in different ways. But he chose to produce every human being in a special way through Adam alayhi salam, and by virtue of that descendancy from Adam alayhi salam, every person that is born now becomes a member of a broader fraternity called humanity, called humankind, or men and women. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has obligated on us as human beings to have a certain degree of interaction with humanity at large. And this bond of humanity obligates us to fulfill the mutual rights of individuals, to give mutual respect to individuals, to have mutual sympathy for human beings, and to be mindful of the general well-being and welfare, as well as the collective good of humanity, as well as everything that serves humanity. As human beings, no matter who we are, wherever we are, Muslims or non-Muslims, blacks or whites, living, speaking any language, eating any kind of food, any gender, whatever it may be, there are some important obligations that we have towards other human beings. And those obligations would be that every person's life and property be safe, that his honor be upheld, that equality and justice and fairness be dispensed with each human being, that they be free to earn a living, that they not be robbed, cheated, backbited, slandered, rebuked, hurt, starved, burnt, or made captives in any way. These are the basic human rights that we have for people. And violation of any of these rights will require not only repentance on the part of the individual, but also restitution of those rights to the other individual. Now, when these human beings are there, there is then a step forwards. We move forwards from the general welfare of human beings, that we start the process of guidance for human beings. Previously, all human beings are made with rights to each other. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Kana an-nasu ummatan wahida." فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْذَرِينَ وَأَنزَلَ مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ لَيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فِي مَخْتَلُفُ فِيهِ. That mankind was one nation. Again, Allah reiterates that. But then he started guiding mankind towards guidance towards himself. And he said, Allah sent messengers with glad tidings and warnings, and with them he sent the book in truth to judge between people in matters wherein they differed. So thus mankind, which was one single nation, now becomes divided into two groups, the believers and the non-believers. Without diluting the rights of the general human beings, now we become a special group of people among the larger group of humanity. And then we become Muslims, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خَلَقَكُمْ فَمِنْكُمْ كَافِرٌ وَمِنْكُمْ مُؤْمِنٌ. That Allah Almighty created you, some of you became believers, and some of you became disbelievers. So now we have two groups, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ هَذَهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُونَ. Now, this ummah of yours is a single ummah. Now, from the humanity becomes another single ummah. That is the ummah of Islam, of Muslims. And he says, I am your Lord, so worship me. And another place he says, فَاتَّقُونَ, that, you know, so fear me. So these two groups of human beings are now divided into non-believers and believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the believers, Udu Rabbakum tazarru'an wa khufya, innahu la yuhibbu al-mu'tadin. That to the general believer, to the general community, he says, call on your Lord with humility and in private, for Allah loves not those who trespass beyond bounds. And he says to them, wala tufsidu fil ardi ba'da islahiha. وَدُوا خَوْفًا وَتَمْعًا إِنَّ رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ مِّنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Do not create mischief on earth after it has been set in order, but call on him with fear and longing in your hearts, for the mercy of Allah is always near those who do good. So now believers are asked to call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like humanity is asked to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and messengers are sent. Now believers are asked to specifically call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do so with humility and in private, collectively in jamaat, and not to create anything that would be considered as disruptive or disruptive for the Muslims, or in other words. So this subset of Brotherhood of Mankind, we start from this subset, started the fraternity, or what we call the Ummah of Islam, the Ummah of Muslims. And then they become now brothers and sisters in faith. Previously, we were brothers and sisters of humanity from Adam alayhi salam. Now we are brothers and sisters in faith by virtue of the kalima, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. And by virtue of our belief in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all that transcends from there, the way of life, etc. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you will see the believers in their mutual kindness and love and sympathy, just like one body. When a limb complains, the whole body responds to it with wakefulness and fever. Now there are bound to be differences amongst our brothers and sisters. You know, this is human nature. We are all part of humanity. We are all born with a human weaknesses and strengths, and there are bound to be differences. There may be differences between individuals, between brothers in the same family, between relatives, between communities, between nations. And so there may be things that will disrupt this particular brotherly relationship that exists between the Muslims themselves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخْوَيْكُمْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. First he says, when such differences arise, first remember that you are brothers first. Step back, re-evaluate that we are actually brothers, we just have a difference, we are not enemies. So we do one thing. And then secondly, we فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخْوَيْكُمْ, that is, that we reconcile between the brothers, that we try to make peace between them. And in doing so, what do? We وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ, that we fear Allah so that he may have mercy on us. Somehow or the other, whenever a dispute arises between two brothers or two Muslims, there are people who will take a position on this side, position on this side. Many, very few people will try to eliminate those and reconcile the differences, fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and making the basis, Islamic teaching as the basis. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam again reminds us of this. He says, whoever clothes a naked Muslim, Allah will clothe him with green robes in paradise. And he who feeds a hungry Muslim, Allah will feed him from the fruits of paradise. And when a Muslim gives drink to a thirsty Muslim, Allah will give him drink from the fountain of Kawthar. Apparently simple things which tend to bring hearts together and reconcile our differences. It is obligatory on us, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, as Muslims, to involve ourselves in the mutual good of the community. Mutual good between people, when there is, we see a rift developing, try to patch it rather than make it a dissenting cause. Often we tend to shy away from responsibilities like this, thinking, oh, it's not my business, you know, let them do it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to at least make an effort to reconcile. If we can do nothing else, to at least not make situations worse. Now let's go one step further from this. Amongst, now we have humanity, then we have Muslims. Now let's go one step further. Allah says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّنَ الْمَاءِ بَشَرًا فَجَعَلَهُ نَسَبًا وَسَهِرًا وَكَانَ رَبُّكَ قَدِيرًا. That it is He who has created man from water, then He has established relationships of lineage and marriage. For your Lord has power over all things. Now amongst the community of Muslims comes the community of family, your lineage, your relatives, those that with whom you have relationships of blood or blood relationships. And these are relationships which are extremely important, the relationships of nasab and relationships of marriage. And so we see now amongst the general brotherhood of Muslims, we have now the family and the blood relatives, and they have a very special status in Islam. And of the relatives that we are there, parents have a very special position. One should not underestimate the blessings of having parents and the blessings of having the opportunity to serve them. And no discussion about a family really can be complete without mentioning the obligations that one has towards their parents. The biggest right on mankind is that of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after that come the rights of the parents. The Quran orders respect and obedience of parents and kindness. وَبِلْ وَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And gratitude. أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِي وَالِدَيْكَ. Gratitude and kindness. Every opportunity, my dear brothers and sisters, to serve one's parents should be considered as a blessing. And this is based on the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For he said, any man, by man you mean men and women, any man who desires that his life be prolonged and that his subsistence, that his rizq, be increased, ought to do good service to his parents and show kindness to them. Apparently, these are two things which do not have any connection. I serve my parents, how is my risk going to be increased? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put blessings in little things which may not have an obvious connection, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses our community. And then he said at another place, let that man be disgraced and disgraced again, and let him be disgraced, he said for the third time, even more. And people inquired, they got worried, who is this man who is going to be disgraced? Who is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And he said, I refer to the man who finds his parents old in age, both of them, or one of them, and yet he did not earn entitlement to paradise by rendering service to them. My advice to the children and the young people of today is that some of our parents may be old, some of them may not be educated, some may come from back home not speaking the language, not knowing the etiquettes of, you know, using this, that, or the other, or etc., etc. They may not be well versed in the ways and the way things work in schools and in colleges and education and this and that. My advice to them still is, show them your humbleness and your patience. If they become critical of you, Show them tolerance and respect. If they are weak and old, give them physical and financial support. If they are invalid, serve them and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the opportunity to do so. And if they have passed away, invoke Allah's mercy on them. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالَدَيْ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابُ. O Lord, grant forgiveness to me and my parents and pardon all the faithful on the day of reckoning. Many of our parents have passed away. The least we can do for them is to make dua for them. Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه says that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم once said that there'll be a person in paradise and his status will be elevated. And he would be astonished. The world, the Darul Amal is gone, dunya is gone, and I'm still getting a little bit of an elevation in my status in the hereafter. He says, when this is elevated, he inquires in astonishment, why is that? I mean, I've been dead. And he said, Allah, and he informed that your offspring have been offering prayers for you and begging mercy for you. And among the three things the Prophet ﷺ said that a person leaves behind which continue to benefit him after death are a recurring charitable sadaqa jariya, knowledge that continues to benefit mankind, and children, pious children, who continue to offer prayers for them. So far, my dear brothers and sisters, we see that we are part of a greater body of mankind. More specifically, we are a part of the Ummah of Muslims. And in the Ummah, we are closest to our family, more specifically to our parents, and vice versa, children to their parents. And in the center of all of this is this poor human being, one single person, who comes into the world with nothing, and he goes out of the world with nothing. That opportunity being provided to us to do something good, to create some assets, to create something, hasanat, that will reward us in the hereafter, inshallah. And all this interaction that we have with our family, with our communities, with the body of Muslims, and with mankind, are those avenues and opportunities that we get to gain some good, to get some good hasanat. And the Quran is again says that whoever does right and receives guidance, it is for his soul, for the individual. And whoever goes astray does it for his own loss. For in the Quran al-Kareem, there's a principle that is stated, La tazru wizratun wizra ukhra. No soul shall carry another soul's burden. And one day, this man will then be brought back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then paid back for all that he has done, good or bad, in this life. And says here that summa tawaffa kullu nafsin ma kasabat wa hum la yuzlamun, that he that every soul be paid what it earned and none shall be dealt with unjustly. So my dear brothers and sisters, what we are talking about today is our role as Muslims, as individuals in the societies that we live in. We are part of the community of Muslims, so we have obligations towards each other. Be mindful of those applications, inshallah. May Allah make it easy on all of us to be mindful. We are part of a larger society. Let us be mindful of those obligations. And then, of course, the humanity at large. Be it our shortcomings, or the influence of shaitan, or the exploitation by others, or the deception by our own selves, the fact is that in the performance of these duties, of these responsibilities, and in the interaction that we have at each and every step of our existence, we shall be tested. There will be situations that will motivate you to do something which is not right for a Muslim. There'll be so situations for you to interact or for us to interact in our at our homes, which we regret afterwards. All the time it happens. I don't know if it happens with you or not, but it happens with me. After an hour, I say, what did I do? Why did I act this way? This is natural. So at every step of our way, we are going to be tested. Because this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to sort out the good guys from the bad guys. He produces evidence, which is undeniable evidence in the hereafter. And we shall be tested sometimes by hunger and poverty. Sometimes we shall be tested by fear. Sometimes by hardship. Sometimes by too much good. Sometimes by loss of things, which may be, you know, wealth or loss of loved ones or loss. Any which way we shall be tested. Somebody betrays your trust. Somebody backbites you. Somebody falsely accuses you of something. You know, these things are going to happen. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that these are the tests that are going to be on each and every one of us. وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالزَّرَّاءِ وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these tests and adversities will come on the people, and that a believer must remain firm and patient in pain and suffering and adversity, and throughout all periods of panic, such are the people of truth, the God-fearing. And they are described in the Quran, as I just mentioned, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ, that those are the people who are the God-fearing people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed each and every one of us, mashallah, with many, many blessings. We can't even count them, not even try to count them. The fact that I've woken up this morning is a blessing. We've walked here. You are sitting here, you are breathing. You have fulfilled, mashallah, the month of Ramadan, or the month of blessing. You're going to be here, Allah knows. But these are all blessings. So little things that interact, that happen between our interpersonal interactions, things that happen which may be tests for us, should be really dealt with on the principles that I just recited. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to reflect on our own shortcomings as well as the shortcomings of our families, etc., so we can try to improve them. Reflect on life in general and the temporal nature, the temporary nature of our existence. That may He allow us to develop that trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge of everything, and we have to do our best that we can and hope for His mercy and His guidance. And that we live in and try to create and take advantage of the little opportunities that come our way. Sometimes they may be so insignificant, a smile on the face towards a brother. I mean, I remember sometimes, you know, you're walking and you're thinking something, and some brothers say, Assalamu alaikum, and you don't even show the emotions on your face. And the brother thinks, I mean, this person is angry with me, or I have hurt that person's feelings because you've not reciprocated in a way. Little things can go a long way, inshallah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create the consider these as hasanat. May Allah forgive our sins. May He unite our hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all the ibadat that were done in the month of Ramadan. May He give us the success in this world and in the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And Eid Mubarak, if I did not say that earlier.